The purpose of this video is to show how to describe the dimensions obtained by a principal component method, such as a principal component analysis, a PCA, or a multiple correspondence analysis, MCA, or a multiple factor analysis, an MFA. Every time we perform a principal component method, we want to describe and to interpret the principal components or the dimensions. So the methodology is the same. We will describe the dimensions thanks to the variables of the raw dataset. To show how to use the dimdesc function that allows one to describe the dimensions, I will take a PCA example. I take the PCA example that I have used in the movie on PCA. So the PCA was performed on a dataset Decathlon. First, I load the library factor miner, then I load the dataset Decathlon, and I perform the PCA on this dataset. The first 10 variables correspond to the performances of athletes during a Decathlon. Variables 11 and 12 are supplementary variables that correspond to the number of points and the rank of the athlete during the Decathlon, and the variable 13 is a categorical variable. The PCA is performed and gives as outputs the variables graph and the individuals graph. I do not interpret these graphs here, but I will give tools to interpret the dimensions. Therefore, there is a dimdesc function of factor minor that can be applied on the result object. This object is obtained from any principal component method. So I just use dimdesc of res. And with this line of code, we try to interpret the dimensions with both continuous and categorical variables. We have a description of the first dimension by continuous variables. So the variable number of points is correlated with the first dimension. The correlation coefficient is equal to 0.956. And the correlation coefficient is significantly different from zero. This means that the variable number of points is linked to the first dimension and can be used to interpret this dimension. Similarly, the variable long jump is positively correlated and the variable 100 meters is negatively correlated to the first dimension. So on the top, we see the variables that are positively correlated to the dimension and on the bottom, the variables that are negatively correlated to the dimensions. The p-values are increasing for the coefficients that are positive, and then the p-values are decreasing. So on the top, we have the most characterizing and positively correlated variables, and on the bottom, the most characterizing variables but negatively correlated to the dimension. So this function is very useful when there is a lot of variables. So, for instance, if you work on a gene dataset and you have 20,000 genes, this tool function will help you to quickly learn which genes are the most correlated, the most linked to the dimension. So, after the results for the first dimension, you have the variables that describe the second and the third dimension. So one remark, the active variables and the supplementary variables are used to characterize the dimension. It is awaited that the active variables are linked to the first dimension since they participated to the construction of the dimension. So even if the correlation coefficient is significantly different from zero, the coefficient should be interpreted with caution. On the contrary, supplementary variables were not involved in the construction of the dimensions. So if they are correlated to the first dimension, we can interpret the strong link between the first dimension and the supplementary variable. So this is more interesting when the variable was not used in the construction of the dimensions. There is no categorical variables that characterize the first dimension because the categorical variables are not sufficiently linked to this dimension. As an example, I will modify the threshold and say that I want all the variables that characterize the dimensions, not for the conventional threshold of 5%, but for a threshold equal to 20%. So by doing this, we have again a characterization of each dimension by the continuous variables. So we recover the same results as before, but now we see that the categorical variables named competition appears to be significant. Therefore, this variable competition is linked to the first dimension. We calculated the square correlation ratio. So the square correlation ratio is the indicator that is used in one-way analysis of variance to see if there is a link between a continuous variable, so the dimension, and a categorical variable, here the variable competition. So the link is significant at a threshold of 20% and not at 5%. This is why the variable does not appear before. So these are the results for an overall link between the dimension and the categorical variables. But we can also see the links from the categories of the categorical variable and the dimension. So we see that the category Olympic Games has a coefficient equals to 0.44, and this coefficient is the hat alpha I coefficient in the one-way analysis of variance with the model the dimension explained by the competition. And the coefficient of the second category, Deca star, is estimated by minus 0.44. So the sum of the coefficients equals zero. We can interpret these results in the following way. The individuals who participated to the Olympic Games have higher coordinate in average on the first dimension, and those who participated to the Deca star have lower coordinates, always in average. So this is much more interesting when you have more than two categories. Then we have the results for the second and the third dimension. So for the second dimension, there are only continuous variables that characterize the second dimension. And for the third dimension, it is the same. There is no categorical variable that characterizes the dimension.